Okay, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Nusira Bello, for actually giving me the opportunity to co-present this evidence-based medicine with you. So I'm actually here to present hierarchy of evidence in evidence-based medicine. Yeah, good evening, everyone. My job tonight is to present the hierarchy of evidence in evidence-based. Evidence-based medicine, by definition, is the consensuous, explicit, judicial and reasonable use of modern best evidence in making decisions about the care of individual patients. The purpose is to actually optimize clinical outcomes and quality of care of patients. It is like non-pharmaceutical care, which has been defined as the responsible provision of drug therapy for the purpose of achieving definite outcomes that will promote and maintain the patient quality of life. In essence, is that you evidence-based medicine will help you to actually take the best decision in making therapeutic choices for the management of your patient. So the purpose of EBM is to actually optimize clinical outcome for your patient care. Now, we move to level of evidence. When you talk of level of evidence, sometimes called hierarchy of evidence, they are assigned to study based on the methodological quality of their design, validity and applicability to patient care. Indirectly, what it's saying is that your level of evidence is actually a function of your research design. Okay? So the different research designs are of different quality. So you can't compare randomized controlled trial with just descriptive studies. So they are of different quality. So the level of evidence is actually determined by the quality of your study design. So this decision actually would not give the grade or strength of recommendation for anything you are doing. So let's say grading quality of evidence, that's setting the no-do gap. What they mean by the no-do gap is that you have an evidence that you already know that it works, and you now go ahead to apply that evidence. So if grading the quality of your evidence, you now have to like that set the no-do gap. How do we know that something works? So what is an evidence-based intervention? And how do we know that we know something? What kind of evidence are sufficient to know that an intervention works? When is an intervention ready for scale up? How do we do more of what works, and how do we do it better? Take a moment and reflect from your research experience or your clinical experience in the past. Maybe you must have done your study when you were in the university or when you were in the West African Postgraduate College. You must have done your studies and you applied different research design or study design, and these are actually a reflection of the quality of the findings you will get from that research. So if you are doing a descriptive study, another person is doing an analytical study, someone is doing a cohort study, cross-sectional studies, those are all different research study design. But at the end of the day, the findings from those study design will actually determine the level of evidence that you will come out with your findings. So thinking about strength of evidence is a one way of grading evidence. This is how we know what we know if we don't do that. So like Dr. Bello has already explained the hierarchy of this evidence, it's like a pyramid. At the base, you have the weak, that is where you have the weakest evidence. And at the top is where you have the strong evidence. And if you look at in between, you have other levels of evidence, like the randomized control, the cohort study, the case control, and all that. But the strongest evidence is actually evidence that emanates from your systematic review or meta-analysis. And the weakest of all the evidence that you may have in your study is actually an expert opinion. An expert opinion, we all know, is like a hypothesis. It should be subjected to randomized controlled trial for it to be accepted as a level one opinion. So these are the seven level of evidence you can find in evidence-based medicine. So now let me give you a breakdown of each of these levels. Now let's look at level one. Level one evidence is actually from the systematic review, or what we call meta-analysis of all relevant randomized controlled trial or evidence-based clinical practice guidelines. This is Dr. Bello has already spoken about standard treatment guideline of any country or World Health Organization. All those work for come under level one evidence. But if you want to take it to research study, systematic review or meta-analysis of all RCTs, of all the randomized controlled trials that have been done, and you pull all these you pull out this randomized controlled trial from different locations, but with the same research question, if you put them together and reanalyze, the finding you get from such study form the level one evidence. So you now move to level two. Level two is actually from a single randomized controlled trial, like a multi-center randomized controlled trial. It's a single study. You are not pulling different randomized controlled studies together to reanalyze. No. But for level two, you are actually doing a well-designed randomized controlled trial from possibly a single multi-center trial. Okay? But for level one evidence, you are actually combining two or three more randomized control studies that have been done elsewhere. You pull them together and reanalyze the results. So meta-analysis actually helps to present a balanced and impartial summary of findings, giving due consideration to any flaw in the evidence. So level two is just a single randomized control trial. So any finding, any evidence you get from that from some study come as level two evidence. Then you have level three. Level three is actually obtained from a well-designed controlled trial without randomization. They call it quasi-experimental study. Okay, you have a treatment group, but you don't have a control. Okay, so any findings that you derive from such study or any evidence you get from such research design actually come as level three evidence. Okay, so we talk about level four. Level four is evidence derived from well-designed retrospective case control or prospective cohort studies. Okay, towards the end of this lecture, I will further break down all these different study designs. I will just give a brief summary and the important feature about all these different study designs much later on in this presentation. Then level five, you talk of a systematic review of descriptive and qualitative studies. It's like a meta-analysis, but this time it is called meta-synthesis. What you are doing is that you are pulling all the different descriptive and qualitative studies that have existed, people have done. You are pulling them together and reanalyzing them to come up with a different finding, and it is called meta-synthesis. Any evidence, any finding from such review is actually come as a level five evidence. It's not as strong as level one, where you have meta-analysis, where you are actually reanalyzing all the different randomized control trials that have been done in different locations. And you are pulling them together to reanalyze to come up with a different finding. So level five is like a level one, but it's a systematic review of descriptive and qualitative studies. So they are not as strong as level one evidence. Then you have level six. Level six is from a single descriptive or qualitative study, like a case series report. What you are doing is just a single descriptive study. You are not pulling different descriptive studies or qualitative studies from different locations and reanalyzing them. No. Level C is just a single descriptive study you have done, maybe in your research project, or maybe when you were in university or in your master's degree or PhD. You just did a study that could be described as single descriptive or qualitative. It's just a single study. You are not pulling different study from different investigators together and reanalyzing them. No. So level seven is called what we call expert opinion, or we call it an anecdotal report. Expert opinion is like somebody who has been working in the clinical setting for a very long time. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Please come.
Yes. So expert opinion is like a hypothesis. It's just like somebody is telling you, I have been using this particular medication to manage this patient, but there is no data to support such practice. So it's the least evidence you can see. So most of the consultants you see in your practice, and they are telling you, I have been using this medication to manage this particular disease condition, and it has been working for me, is expert opinion. Even as a pharmacist, when you go to the ward and you are taking your drug therapy intervention, and you are telling the doctor, this drug A is drug B is better than drug A, if you don't support it with any study or any standard treatment guideline, it becomes an expert opinion. So let's move on to the next step. I will just give a brief summary, some brief characteristics of all the different level of evidence I have just presented, like level one evidence, meta-analysis, systematic review, study design. Key features of this kind of study design includes an overview of primary studies of usually two or more. And like I have said before, for this kind of study, you are actually pulling randomized control studies that have been done by different people, but with the same research question, with the same objective, and you are reanalyzing them again to come up with a different finding, where you have to like any finding that any evidence that is that you get from such re-evaluation or reanalysis becomes a level one evidence. This type of study is typically conducted according to unambiguous and reproducible methodology in framing the appropriate question of interest for a systematic review. Four key elements designated by the acronym PICO are required. Dr. Lucy Rabillo has already spoken about PICO. I don't want to go over that again. So level two evidence is what I told you is called single randomized controlled trial. You are not reanalyzing multiple studies that have been done with a randomized controlled trial. You are not reanalyzing. This is just a single randomized controlled trial that has been conducted. Maybe University of Calabar Teaching Hospital has decided to do a study on a particular research question, and they come up with their finding. And at the end of the day, it becomes a level two evidence because the study design is randomized controlled trial, which is the gold standard. So the characteristics of this kind of study design are as follows. Study is designed to compare different interventions or treatments. What you do here is that you try to randomize your patient into a treatment group or a control group. Then you now pick the agent of interest, like maybe a drug you want to actually assess its effectiveness. You want to try whether this drug that people have made so much claim about its effectiveness, whether it actually works on those patients. What you do is to randomize patients into a treatment group and into a control group. For the treatment group, you now apply the drug that have been, you know, that have been tutored to be very effective in that particular disease condition. You apply it to the treatment group, while the control group, you give them placebo. And at the end of the day, you try to compare the result of the two groups. So that is about level two evidence. That is single randomized control trial. So talking about what are the features of this randomized control trial, there is also need to define the control treatment in terms of whether it's an active treatment or placebo or no treatment at all. I've already explained that. In order to preserve the randomization process and avoid bias, blinding of the subject or principal investigator or both. So what that means is that when the result of ROCT study, I'm hearing so echo. Hello.
Continue.
Yeah, okay. What you do there is you randomize the patient into treatment and control group. Then the treatment of interest is applied to the treatment group, while the control group, you just give them placebo. At the end of the day, you compare the two groups and see whether the alcohol of interest is actually BC in the treatment group. Okay, so that is what happens when you do randomized control studies and all the other features of a randomized control study. So level three evidence is what we call passing experimental studies. Features of this kind of study design include manipulation of an independent variable. When you say manipulation of an independent variable, you tried the agent of interest, you actually apply it and see whether there is actually an outcome of interest that you're actually interested in. So in this type of study design, at least one characteristic of a true experiment is missing. There is no control group in this. In quasi experimental, you may have a treatment group and you may not have a control group, okay? It's like maybe you want to try to see whether insecticide treated bed net, whether it actually can be used to control the infection of malaria. Maybe in a particular community, you tell them to use insecticide treated bed net to sleep, while there's another community where they may not even be using that. You want to, at the end of the day, you want to check the rate of infection in those kind of study population. So in quasi experimental, you may not have a control group, you just have a treatment group. At times you may have a control group, but it's not compulsory. That's what makes it quasi experimental. And in quasi experimental, the patients or the participants are not randomized into control or treatment group. So level four evidence is called case control or prospective cohort study. Some features of case control studies are, in this type of study, a group of affected persons with the disease is compared with a suitably matched control group of non-affected persons. The most important thing, the take-home point here is that there must be a prior exposure when you are trying to divide the two groups into control and into control and a case. There must be a prior exposure to the that was why it's prior exposure to the disease. So it is a good design of evaluating exposure that cannot be randomized. So because you cannot randomize patient into control and maybe treatment group, because for case control study, what you normally do is that is usually you actually apply this kind of study design for a rare disease condition, not a common disease. And once a disease condition is rare, it's very difficult to actually find the sample size for you to randomize it to control and treatment group. Because of that one, because you cannot actually do that, because if you're actually randomizing patient into control and treatment group, it then means you're actually doing randomized control study. But for case control, because this sample size is very small, because it is actually a study design that is used for study of a rare disease condition, you actually have to like use case control instead of using randomized control trial. For prospective cohort studies, so elements of cohort study design include, these are the strongest of all observational studies. In cohort study, we know that the exposure happens before the outcome. So what you do is that you apply a particular intervention, then over time, you now watch the outcome to see whether the outcome of interest will manifest in those groups you have actually applied that intervention. Then you also have a suitably matched control group that the intervention is not applied to them. So what you do here is that at the end of the day, you try to find out after over time, you now try to find out whether the treatment of interest you are interested in, whether the outcome of interest has actually manifested in the group you have exposed that agent to. Then the control group, you have to compare the results to also the control group and all that. So after comparing the incidence of the two groups, then you proceed to calculate what we call the relative risk. You calculate the relative risk of the treatment group and the other group that you have not applied the treatment. So depending on the value of the relative risk, you will now know whether there is a causal effect relationship at the end of the day. So level 5 evidence is evidence from systematic review of descriptive and qualitative studies. I've already talked about this. You pull all the descriptive study that has ever been done and the qualitative study that has ever been done. You pull them together and reanalyze, and that gives you the findings you get from such reanalysis will give you level 5 evidence. Then we'll now talk about level 6, evidence from a single descriptive study. I've told you before, this one, you are not actually pulling studies from different people together. You are actually looking at a single study of descriptive or qualitative study design, and you are actually, the finding from such studies will actually form level 6 evidence. So the level 7 evidence is what I call expert opinion, or expert committee's opinion, or an expert report. It is the least evidence in the hierarchy of evidence in evidence business, or evidence-based pharmaceutical care practice. Evidence is usually based on personal experiences, and in all cases, evidence is not usually supported by scientific data. I will just tell you that the person will tell you, for a very long time, I've had the experience of using this particular agent to treat this disease condition, but there's no data to support it. That forms level 7 evidence. So though the use of the best evidence in evidence-based medicine or evidence-based practice is essential and encouraged, evidence from personal experience, judgment, and theory cannot be entirely discarded since it constitutes valuable ingredients in healthcare practice. For the fact that we said that level 7 evidence is the weakest evidence you can ever apply to manage a patient, but you cannot totally discard it, because you see how to apply personal experiences, expert opinion, to actually manage patients. So in essence, what I'm trying to say in essence is that the relevance of evidence-based medicine is applicable in pharmaceutical care. When you go to a ward, or you are involved in a joint clinical rotation with physicians and all that, and you want to make drug therapy intervention, there is no need to start arguing with your multidisciplinary team member. There is no need for that. So if you identify a drug therapy problem, then try as much as possible to support it with either level 1 or level 2 evidence. And that stops the argument, because if you don't do that, there will be this friction between team members in the team that are actually managing that patient. So what I always advise a pharmacist that goes on the joint clinical rotation with physician to do is always try and make sure that you arm yourself with the best available evidence for you to take a good decision in the management of that patient. Thank you, everyone. So that is what I have to say about evidence-based, hierarchy of evidence-based medicine.
Thank you, Dr. Abini.
Yeah.
So, Dr. Bello, are you
to summarize?
Dabelu?
All right, yes. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes, you are very right. You're
all right. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much for
5 minutes to do that. 5 minutes to do that.
Thank you very much for the quick summary, Dr. Agbeni. Yeah. So yeah. Dr. Agbeni just finalized the third step of the evidence-based medicine practice model. So the fourth step would be for us to apply our evidence to our patients. So in doing that, we discuss whatever outcomes we have obtained from our evidence search and appraisal. We discuss it with the patients, discuss the options, the risk, and the benefits. And then if you're working as part of a team, you have to discuss this with your team members. If you've identified any change that deviates from normal clinical practice, this will be discussed with the team member responsible for the care of the patient. And then it is important that you now document such deviation. And then in order to prevent you having to go back to go through all those stages again, it's important that you try to incorporate the new findings into the routine clinical practice, and this can be disseminated to other arms of organization as well, so that they can also put that into practice, and that kind of saves time and energy for clinicians. And like Dr. Agbeni has highlighted, evidence-based medicine now, we did talk about the first step, which is asking the question. The second step, which was acquiring the evidence-based medicine to answer the question. The third step was to appraise the evidence, which Dr. Agbeni was able to expatiate on. And then the fourth step, which is now applying to the patient. So at this stage now, we are bringing in the patient's value with the evidence that we have obtained and our clinical expertise, all three together, to now provide the patient the relevant intervention. So another important benefit of evidence-based medicine practice is that, like Dr. Agbeni too said, we have to sometimes, and like I said earlier on before he came in, sometimes it's our desire to go for the highest level of evidence. But the reality we have is that we might not always find that evidence in that level. We might have to do with expert opinions only, which if that is the only kind of evidence that is available. So what this creates is an opportunity for us to be able to carry out research on that area that we have found that there is a gap, in order for us to be able to carry out research that will be of direct impact to patient care. So this helps to also build research practice that is more focused to patient outcomes. And the fifth step of the evidence-based medicine model is now to assess our performance. Because after doing all the four steps, we have to be able to assess our performance into what we're doing right and what we're not doing properly and what we need to do better the next time. And this is like an ongoing process. It's not a sprint that you finish. You have to keep reevaluating yourself. And like the main founder of evidence-based medicine said, he has recommended that the best way we can evaluate ourselves is by self-evaluation. And this is by evaluating each of the step of evidence-based medicine practice model. So what you do is that the first step, which has to do with asking the clinical question, you reevaluate yourself. Am I asking any clinical questions at all? Are these questions well formulated? Am I using the map? Can I get myself unstuck when I'm asking the question? Do I have a working method? The same thing goes on for the step two, which was to acquire the evidence. Evaluate yourself following the following steps. And the slides will be made available for every participant that wants to have the slide, so that we can at least go through some of this information at our spare time, because unfortunately, due to time, I won't be able to read out everything. So the most important thing is that when we're the fifth step of evidence-based medicine is to always assess our performance. Research shows that this is the least step that is being performed by most clinicians, but it's an actually important step, because if we don't evaluate ourselves, we don't know what we're doing right and what we're doing wrong. And so you can follow all these processes to try and to practice and see if you can use this and apply to your practice. So other than assessing each step, like asking questions, acquiring evidence, appraising the evidence, and applying the evidence, other than following each step, we can also analyze or reflect on our practice in a general way. As a group, we can ask, are we practicing this? Why are we practicing what we're doing? Are we doing it right? Are we adhering to best practices? So if we're in a group of collaborative team or care of patient, a group care or team caring for a patient, we can ask ourselves these general questions in order for us to be able to ensure that we're actually carrying out evidence-based medicine. So the questions are, why are we practicing this way? Are we adhering to best practices? Can we produce better outcomes with consistency? So we can go through all those information later on. And so that comes to the important aspect that concerns us as pharmacists. I know every aspect I've tried to generalize to clinicians, but along the line, Dr. Ebenitu has made the inference that evidence-based medicine is an important concept for pharmacies. It helps us to carry out pharmaceutical care or medication therapy management appropriately, because this is in fact more important than ever, because before, pharmacies were practicing as dispensers, and it was okay for us to have our drug information and not to bother about any other thing. But we pharmacy practice has migrated from dispensing or supplying, being suppliers of medicines only, and we have now migrated and into more patient-oriented care. So it is important that we try to incorporate evidence-based medicine in order to be able to provide more effective and efficient pharmaceutical care or medication therapy for our patients. And this does not apply to only inpatients. It can also apply to outpatient, it can apply to community pharmacy and hospital pharmacy, any setting that we're carrying out any direct patient care. And this care model, this pharmacist patient care process, has been advocated. This shouldn't be new to us. Actually, if we try and incorporate this care model into practice, this will allow us, and this shows that pharmacies are even recognized to be providing evidence-based medicine. So in this care model, which you can use the mnemonic CAPIF, because that's what I used to remember. It's collect, assess, plan, implement, and follow up. This is a pharmaceutical care model that has been recommended by a Joint Commission of Care in America. And these stages of practice involve collecting of information, assessment of the information, planning the care of the patient, implementing and follow up. And within this model, assessment and the collection. The collection, assessment, and plan follows the SOAP format. So you collect your subjective information, objective information, and then you assess the patient, and then you plan your intervention. And within the planning stage, that is when you also apply evidence-based model practice, so that you ensure that the patient gets the best pharmaceutical outcome. So as pharmacists, we have to have, this shows that as pharmacists, we have to have a clear understanding We have to have a clear understanding of the concept and techniques of evidence-based medicine. We need to be able to keep up to date with the latest research evidence and the clinical practice guideline. And we have to understand the methodologies of critical appraisal of evidence, which was what Dr. Agbeni expatiated on. So it's obvious that pharmacists are providing evidence-based medicine or evidence-based practice, like the other terminology we identified earlier on. But the concern now, or the question now, is that are we practicing evidence-based medicine appropriately the way we should be practicing it? There's evidence that pharmacists, like clinicians, may not be adopting evidence-based medicine appropriately as it should be. However, I cannot make any valid assessment, because I try to look for a study to determine any study that has looked into knowledge, behavior, barriers of practice of evidence-based medicine among pharmacists in Nigeria. I wasn't able to find that. So I'm just assuming now that we as pharmacists, clinicians, are actually practicing evidence-based medicine. But the question now is, are we practicing it very well? So with the presentation that has been given tonight, I hope that we have learned something that we can now take onto our practices. But like everything, there's barriers, and there are barriers and there are challenges. And so I kind of highlighted this study among resident doctors in Nigeria, because I thought that would fit more into our own, that would resonate more with us back in Nigeria. So we can look into some of the findings of this study and see how that concerns us. The lack of time that I've highlighted there is a factor that is universal. The studies have shown that lack of time has been a barrier for, or a challenge for clinicians to practice evidence-based medicine. But like the processes we have gone through tonight, if you are able to apply those stages, those techniques, the 5 A's, and you are able to learn how to critically appraise the evidences in very succinct manner that we have listed tonight, hopefully we'll be able to manage more time, save more time. And then along with these barriers, they have stated the study was able to find out from the clinicians some of the strategies that could be used to minimize these, to overcome these barriers. So we might look at some of these strategies and see if we can apply it to our own practice settings. So I've summarized some of these strategies and also other strategies that are found from the literature and put them together, and probably we'll be able to use the strategies in order that to enhance our practice so that we can practice more of evidence-based medicine practice. So it is important that evidence-based medicine, like we have seen so far, it is important that it's integrated into our curriculum if pharmacists or clinicians in general would, if they are expected to be able to practice this effectively when they begin to practice in the future. And other ways of being able to implement evidence-based medicine is to incorporate into the continuous professional education. Also, evidence-based medicine can be enhanced if we practice as a team, in a collaborative team, and which pharmacists are doing at the moment. And other ways we can also enhance evidence-based medicine practice is to be able to follow the steps of the 5 A's that we have listed in a strategic manner for medical conditions that we see every day. It's advisable that we spend more energy on those conditions so that we can stay up to date with whatever information, whatever evidence are available in the literature. And for conditions that are rare, we can spend more, less time and take more of our time and work as a team and as part of the team and address those questions, those conditions with less of energy than we do with conditions that we see regularly. And if we're using practice guidelines, like we have highlighted earlier on, practice guidelines have their limitations. So whenever you apply a practice guideline,
you have 2 minutes to go.
right, you apply a practice guideline and it deviates from normal, it is advisable that you document it and you also disseminate the information of the deviation to other practicing members. So then the following steps, strategies, are what our healthcare managers too can employ so that they can enhance evidence-based medicine in practice. So these are some of the key points of the presentation, that evidence-based medicine is new, but it's a practice that has transformed medical practice, and we have to be able to understand how it works and implement it in our practice. The goal of evidence-based medicine is to optimize patient outcomes, and by optimizing patient outcomes, there are studies that have shown that that has improved the quality of healthcare, and it helps to reduce the cost of healthcare. And we follow, in order to practice evidence-based medicine, we have to adopt the five steps that were listed earlier on, and by asking clinically relevant answerable questions, we'll be able to find appropriate research evidences that matches those clinical questions. And also, evidence-based medicine is not a sprint. It's not something, it helps, it continues to improve our clinical performance throughout our years of practice. So by implementing evidence-based medicine, it helps us to be better clinicians and in providing the adequate care for our patients over our span of practice. And as highlighted in the final stages of the presentation, it is important that as pharmacists and at the stage we are now, that we are able to also adopt evidence-based medicine practice into our practice. So I'd like to acknowledge Dr. Adragbeni for doing this presentation with me, all the members of CPAN, those who have been able to be here tonight, appreciate it for coming in, National Chairman, and the elders of PSN. I'm sorry, Doctor. I identified Elder Lulu Ojo, I think, and other elders here. Kwara State PSN and every other person. And sorry, I was supposed to invite a friend from Australia who was supposed to give a 5-minute talk, but unfortunately I couldn't get him over to the meeting. It was an oversight from my side. So thank you for listening and thank you for your time again.
Thank you, Dr. Bello, Mr. Rat, and Dr. Agbeni Andrew for that great and very impactful information. Very detailed, so informative and very educative. But time is so spent. We don't have more time to go. But for the next 5 minutes, I want to leave room for at least one or two contributions before I call on the National Chairman, Dr. Yusuf Madu, to give the closing remark. At least we welcome at least one or two contributions or questions for the presenters. Is there any? I want to unmute everybody so that we can make our contribution. So you have been permitted to unmute yourself. If you have any questions, can you raise up your hand so that we call on you?
And hello, good open, evening.
Yeah, please.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, thank you very much. I am Dr. Oluwatoyin Ojo from Lagos.
You're welcome.
I have been so, I'm so happy I'm on this meeting this evening. It has been great listening to Drs. Bello and Drs. Agbeni. And I want to say that this is the right kind of presentation we should be listening to as clinicians, as clinical pharmacists, at this stage of our profession. This is what we should be listening to, because that is what is going to give us the niche that we need out there. Evidence-based medicine is going to end all the contention with our healthcare professionals. Yeah. And I want to say that, is there a way we need to escalate on tonight's presentation? We need to find a way to get it across to every clinical pharmacist, the maybe the slides. Then we need to find a way to make it as a policy to pass it on to the greater pharmacy body, because this is the way forward for us as a profession. I'm so happy and I'm so proud of the two presenters of tonight, and I want to thank you very much for the coordinators of CPAN.
Thank you, Dr. Ojo, for that one. Any other contributions or comment for the presenters, please? we need one more because our closing time is 11 o'clock. Okay, please, Dr. Afsat, your horn. Dr. Afsat, can you come to the front, please? Dr. Afsat Adesina. Okay, in the absence of further contribution and questions, I want to call on Dr. Joseph Madu, our chairman, to please give us the closing remarks, please. Dr.
Good evening. Madu? Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, I want to thank Dr. Aike Bello for being the chief technical officer and making sure that everything has gone well tonight. I want to thank every other person for the time they have spent in making this meeting a success. I'm so happy, it's my passion, pharmacy. I love pharmacy to my bones. And I'm so happy that the way CPAN is moving and the passion, the knowledge, everything that we are bringing into CPAN and into the practice. We thank God. I can say to God be all the glory. I want to thank my brother, Dr. Agbenin, and my sister, Dr. Nusirat. I hope you're with me. I hope you can hear me clearly.
Yes, very clear.
I have learned a lot this night. All this Dr. Agbenin's level one, level seven, and all this. Many of us have learned a lot. God bless you. I thank you so much for bringing out the time to really enrich our brains and our bank of knowledge. We are now richer. I can see that CPAN is doing a lot and clinical pharmacies are doing a lot. I also want to thank my sister, Dr. Ojo Rada, who said some of these things should be passed on to the greater body. There are a lot of senior pharmacists, senior colleagues, and even people from PCN and the rest of them. We have a lot of plans, and we are taking notes of all the ideas, suggestions, and everything that are coming up. One thing I told people when we met at the last PSN conference in Kaduna was that the major problem of pharmacy in Nigeria is that their major problem is implementation. But with CPAN, we are always going to walk our talk, no matter how long it takes us. We are noting down a lot of things, and we want to make sure that we are going to implement every good idea, every good suggestion, because that's the only way that our profession will move forward. A profession is what the practitioners make of it. Let me just summarize by thanking all of you for your time. Most importantly, it's not easy bringing out the time and doing all these things. May God Almighty bless you, bless every one of us, and the good Lord who has been with CPAN, may He continue, forgive us all our sins, and continue to be with us. In Jesus' mighty name, I have prayed too.
Amen.